Okay, good morning everyone and welcome to the sixth meeting of the Local Government Communities Committee. Can I remind everyone present to turn off mobile phones and as the meeting papers are provided in digital format, tablets may be used by members during the meeting. So that's what you'll see is doing if you see on electronic devices this morning. We've got a full house again this morning and no apologies been received from MSP members, and we move straight to agenda item one, which is subordinate legislation. So the committee will take evidence on the council tax substitution of proportion Scotland Order 2016, and can I welcome this morning Councillor Kevin Keenan, spokesperson for resources and capacity, and Jonathan Sharma, policy manager at COSLA, Paul Manning, Scottish Local Government Partnership and executive director of finance and corporate resources at South Lanarkshire Council, Derek Yule, director of finance Highland Council and current chair of SIPFA, directors of finance, and finally, Dave Watson, Head of Policy and Public Affairs, Unison Scotland. So, good morning, gentlemen. Thank you for coming along to give evidence in this statutory instrument. We've got a few opening, hopefully brief statements to allow us to get more time for questions. Can I ask Councillor Keenan to make his statement?
Okay, Chair. Thanks very much for that. Obviously, COSLA welcome the opportunity to come along here today and present our case. I believe we've given evidence or written evidence, and we're obviously here to take questions on that in way of support. If I can just say a few things that we think it doesn't, the reform doesn't go far enough. We believe that the government need to publicise the increases that they intend to make in band E and above by way of multiplier. We need to clearly know whether there is a multiplier factor going to go into water charges, and perhaps some of our other colleagues will be able to talk on that more technically. We think that the changes that are imposed on local government by way of a tax to fund a national project breaks the link between local taxation and delivering local services. And we believe that there could have been a much more fairer and more equitable way to deliver these level of changes. And indeed, the commission that was worked on between COSLA and the Scottish Government had a number of proposals that we would have liked to see implemented that would have been much fairer moving forward. I'll just leave it at that.
Thank you very much, Councillor Keenan. Derek Gill.
Thank you, Convener. And again, like Councillor Keenan, welcome the opportunity to give evidence this morning. I think similarly, obviously, our point of view will come from the professional perspective and the challenges of implementing. And I think one of my focuses would be on the accountability of the tax proposals and the perceived fairness of these and some of the challenges that might present. Again, I would highlight the water issue as one issue we feel the Scottish Government hasn't addressed in the proposals yet at all, completely silent on that issue. And in terms of ease of implementation of the proposed changes, clarification of that we would see as a major issue, depending on how the government wishes to proceed. That's all I really wish to say at this stage. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Yule. And finally, Dave Watson.
Can I say at the outset that Unison welcomes the end to the council tax freeze, something we argued for some time. We also welcome some improvement in the progressivity of the bans, and we support obviously anything which helps low-income households cope with the increases in council tax. However, there's a but, as you'll not be surprised, and that is that we've always argued for a full review of the council tax, not just, frankly, a few tweaks. We don't believe the ban changes are progressive enough. We're particularly concerned that there's to be no revaluation, leaving the bans at 1991 values. And we don't like the proposals essentially for ring fencing of the 100 million revenues from additional banding or the cap on the council tax increase. We believe that undermines local democracy. Essentially, we believe the government should treat local government as local government and not as local administration.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Watson. I think Mr. Watson making some reference to the council tax reduction scheme in terms of helping lower income families. For clarity, whilst we may ask questions in relation to that and we have some comments to make on it, any information we get in relation to that we will give to the Social Security Committee, who's actually looking at the statute instruments in relation to that. And just to put on the record, the terms of reference of our call for evidence, which doesn't restrict you from additional comments, but we asked overall, do you support the principle of the government's plans to reform council tax? To what extent will the government's proposed reforms make the council tax system fairer? To what extent will the changes be straightforward for local authorities to implement? Do you support the government's planned changes to council tax reductions and any additional comments? And of course, we've got written evidence around those headings. So I thank you very much for that. Can we move to our first question from Graeme Simpson?
Thanks, Convener. Just to start off, I'll declare an interest in that I'm a councillor still in South Lanarkshire. Can I ask you, gents, and any one of you or all of you can answer, around the costs of implementation, what you think they'll be, and also do you think at the end of this that any councils will lose money?
I'd be delighted for you all to answer, but you don't have to all answer. I should point out there are five of you, but who would like to start on that? Councillor Keenan.
We're hoping that councils won't lose money and you'd be supportive of the suggestion that the government should pick the tab up for any administration costs. We believe that there will be administration costs and there's ongoing work at the moment to gather these costs together. So the plea would be that councils don't lose out and that the administration costs are picked up by the Scottish Government. Perhaps somebody can give them their technical coverage on how they believe these costs will be accumulated, but at the moment they're being gathered up.
Okay, thank you very much, Councillor Keenan. Derek,
you. Yeah, thank you. I mean, maybe just to add to that, as Councillor Keenan says, costs are being collected just now. I think one point I would make is I think probably every council in the country would say that they're not fully funded for the administrative costs of council tax reduction scheme at the moment. So again, we would stick with the request that the changes are fully funded. I think I would refer to the point I made earlier about water. Because in terms of system changes and the cost of changes to our systems, we do see that as a fundamental issue. If the multiplier were not to apply to water charges, I think there's a possibility we'd end up with two different sets of billing if you're applying different bandings for council tax. So I think while we are collecting information, that is a major point for us in terms of further clarification required. If water is treated differently from council tax, there are huge efficiencies at the moment in collecting that together in a single bill. If you introduce differential charging, that will create a major problem.
Okay. Paul Manning?
Just to add to Councillor Keenan's comments around administration costs, in terms of council tax reduction, there's obviously going to be an additional caseload and there'll be a processing and administrative cost for that. You're also likely to have more people contacting authorities to say that they don't understand the system, and there will obviously be an administrative burden in trying to deal with that. Potentially following on from that, you will have issues around people lacking the ability to pay the increased charges, and that may spill over into a cost for councils.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Manning. Mr. Sharma?
Yeah, just to add to the comments, just to say that we are undertaking an exercise at the moment with a number of representative councils to look at the costs, and the Scottish Government officers are quite well aware of that, and they are anticipating receiving something from us fairly shortly. We're committed to producing something that is robust and recognises the genuine additional costs that we think that councils are going to occur as a result of this. So that's the piece of work that's happening at the moment, just to clarify.
Dave Watson.
The only small point I'd add to is that, you know, we have obviously asked, we represent obviously the staff who would have to administer these changes, I have to say they are already under considerable pressure as a result of the salami slicing of staffing levels, so any additional workload would need to be funded.
Okay, thank you very much. Graeme Simpson, do you want to come back on some of that?
Mr. Sharma, interesting what you say there. Have you got a time scale for this piece of work?
Effectively within the next week or so, we'll be producing something back to Scottish Government. We'll then need to discuss a process for how those costs then get looked at further, and also how that then feeds into any of the spending review discussions that are going on at the moment. So we'll have to find a way how that goes into the that process.
And are you trying to get an overall figure of additional costs across Scotland, or is it authority by authority?
What we'll do is we'll work it up from the sample. So we've tried to make sure that the sample is representative, that it covers city councils, covers rural, covers the different types of council and their scale. We will build that up to give a full Scotland picture, and that's what we'll put to the government officers.
It'll be useful for the committee to have that information, I think, convener, once it's ready.
Specifically, thank you. Specifically on this point, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, convener. Can I just carry on from what we've just discussed? For this to work effectively, there needs to be a good communication policy at council level and at government level. I'm not quite aware yet what the government are planning to put out, but what are you planning to deal with in your own areas to ensure that there is a good communication network between yourselves and your taxpayers? To ensure that there's no confusion, because otherwise you are going to get an awful lot more phone calls to your call centres. You're going to have to deal with the whole aspect of relief that people may have to deal with in that whole process. And time is tight between now and its implementation. So what areas in communication do we have in hand, and what areas in communication do we see as potential problems and pitfalls as we move forward?
Anyone want to take that? Councillor Keenan?
That we believe that the government, as it's their tax that will increase the extra burden on the bands from E upwards, that they need to clearly publicise what they intend to do and make sure that individuals across Scotland know exactly what is expected and what they will pay. Obviously, you hear today that we're unsure as to whether a multiplier is added to water, and if that's the case, then that will be another part of that communication that government need to put out. We feel it's their responsibility, as it's their tax and their programme of work that they intend to fund through using local government, although we do think it breaks the link to that local tax being used in local areas, because it may be collected and handed out in other parts of the country.
We'll maybe get some more comments on that in a moment. I know some other members want to ask about public awareness and communication, and we'll move on to that in a second, but just to kind of finish on the line of questioning that Mr Simpson was going down, has there been any discussions, say, between COSLA and the Scottish Government in relation to administrative costs?
Personally, I haven't been part of the spending review costs, but I would imagine that a meeting, I think it will probably happen today, I would dare say it is something that the president of COSLA will be raising with Derek Mackay.
Okay, so I'm trying to be clear. I mean,
it's on our radar to make sure that that we try to get a resolve.
But it's not been formally raised yet. But you intend to do that, possibly even today.
I'm not sure what it's formally arranged. I'm not part of the negotiating team that's negotiating on the spending review at this moment in time. However. As we see costs coming in the direction of COSLA, we're usually quick enough to try to address them with government.
Okay, because clearly the committee would be keen to know that the government's listening to the representations you're making, which is why I was specifically asking whether those representations had actually been made yet. But no, obviously you're not in a position to...
Not in a position to confirm that.
To confirm that. Well, it would be quite helpful if we could get that information, because that helps inform us when we take evidence from Derek Mackay. I think it's next week that we do that. I suppose the only other thing I would say, and it's me asking this question, but there's a kind of running joke perhaps with MSP sometimes that when additional responsibilities are put onto local government, that COSLA goes high with the actual cost and the government goes low with the actual cost, and the actual cost sits somewhere in between. So in terms of it becomes a negotiating position almost in terms of cost recovery. So I'm just wondering, in terms of those discussions that you have with the Scottish Government, will you share with them your modelling work in relation to cost and sit down with Scottish Government officials to see if you have an agreed methodology and approach and framework to that, rather than just a number emerging?
And I think that's always been the case, where we would share the methodology and how that's collected. You obviously heard from Mr. Sharma on how that was intended to work up the figure that we intend to present. So we're not trying to hide anything in the costs that we present, and I don't think that we give overly inflated prices when we try to recover the actual costs, but that'll be a matter of opinion.
Of course, I just wanted to give you the opportunity to put that on the record, Mr. Yule.
Yes, and maybe just to add to that, I mean, my expectation would be that through COSLA collating the information, there will be a degree of sense check applied to the figures to see there's a consistent approach coming through from council so that the figures do look reasonably robust and are justifiable. Certainly experience in previous government fundings, I do recognise the point that you make, and certainly I've been aware of fairly robust challenging from civil servants in terms of what local government is putting forward, and equally a fairly strong defence justification of figures that are put forward. So I would have anticipated a similar sort of discussion taking place. I think it's important before we put forward figures that they do have that sense check applied to them first of all.
Actually helpful. And Mr. Manning, you represent four local authorities not in COSLA. Are you letting COSLA lead on this? Are you looking at costs for your local authorities? What's happening with the Scottish Local Government Partnership?
Okay, we are looking at costs for our authorities. I mean, in terms of what I can tell you, it's reflected in the submission that we've given. The software suppliers we're working with have advised that the main amendments, you know, should be deliverable within the timescales that they have to be. The risk issue, and this is what gives a difficulty, I think, in defining a cost, in part relates to this waste and wastewater issue. And again, as we've said in our submission, if we're left in a position where we have to maintain dual multipliers, as in different multiplier rates for water and for council tax, then that represents an additional and a significant challenge. And it's that uncertainty at this point that I think prevents me, you know, giving you a definitive figure.
To be fair, I don't think we're asking for the figure. We're asking that those discussions take place with the Scottish Government. Just finally, in relation to that, the methodology that the Scottish Local Government Partnership uses, will it be the same as the methodology COSLA uses?
Well, in essence, we're working with the same software suppliers. We're going to be dealing with the same administration issues. I don't see that there would be any difference in methodology in terms of working out the cost.
Okay, so we shouldn't expect a variation in figures, and I think there's conversation takes place between the four local authorities and COSLA in relation to that.
In terms of dialogue between the four local authorities and government on spending review issues.
COSLA.
Right, with COSLA, and from the perspective of dialogue with COSLA, no, I'm not involved in direct dialogue with COSLA on this. We make representation to the government through the settlement and distribution group.
Okay. Thank you. Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, Convener, and welcome to the committee. I just want to follow on a little bit from what Alexander Stewart was talking about in terms of awareness. There's been no change in the multiplier since 1993. There's been no change in the rate of council tax since the freeze in 2007. There are new council tax reduction eligibility criteria being introduced. There's a question of the redistribution of receipts to other local authorities. There's a question you raised about water and sewerage charges. The question I have is, there's two distinct elements of public awareness here. There's one, a general public awareness that this is happening and these changes are coming into play. And then there's a question about how you communicate that directly to council tax payers. To what extent do you think we need a public awareness exercise that alerts people to the fact that these changes are all being made and to anticipate them? And to what extent do you think you can communicate the actual changes and why they're being made on the actual council tax billing that you send out to people? Because one of the comments we got in the tax commission, which I sat on, was that council taxpayers didn't feel they were getting as much information as they could, or it wasn't presented in that kind of way that was easily digestible with modern infographics, etc. Is there a job you could do there? But the first question is about the general awareness campaign to anticipate, so the public can know this is all happening.
OK, can maybe come to Dave Watson first. Was it your members in the front line that are going to have to deal with those telephone calls, explaining away why bills have changed and altered and increased? So, Mr. Watson.
Yes, I mean, I think as we said in our evidence and into our evidence also to the Commission and elsewhere, one of the challenges of the council tax is that people receive a bill. It's not like VAT or income tax when it's deducted from source, and therefore people are going to be faced this year with some, in many cases, quite big changes. And there's a huge amount of concern among the staff, a range of staff. It's not just those. There is some work in call centres, as Mr. Stewart pointed out, but there's an awful lot of staff also in what we call the front line, in terms of the one-stop shops and places like that, who people just come in off the street and obviously raise those issues. Staff are concerned that there's going to be a heightened concern when people get that. People, frankly, don't always understand it. Remember, we've come off from a very long council tax freeze, and therefore this will be a change, albeit there has been the water element, as colleagues have indicated. What we are seeing more generally has been in our annual survey of abuse and violence demonstrates a significant increase in recent years in both verbal and physical abuse towards local authority staff. It's gone up fairly significant year on year, and clearly, therefore, we're very concerned about that. What we accept that at present there are a lot of uncertainties, there are still things to be sorted out, and therefore the detail might not be there, but we do think with this type of communication exercise you can't start too soon, and therefore we would urge, and we don't frankly care if it's government, council, whoever does it, but we would urge a very major communication effort to explain the changes so that it's not our members who get the grief on the doorstep.
Okay, thank you. Anyone else want to come in? Councillor Keenan?
I think that if local government make a choice to put up council tax themselves and they're held at 3%, then a bandee in that area could see itself going up to by 10.5%. And I think it's incumbent upon government to make sure that they take the responsibility for the part that they're putting up, that being the 7.5% that they're adding, and that they need to communicate that to people. Obviously, within the sort of limited letter that goes out via council tax, no doubt, council will try their best to explain that proportion is in relation to the government policy, that's pretty limited. I think that government itself need to take the responsibility and try to make sure that people that are likely to see a 20-odd% increase, because the higher band that they sit on, having had a council tax freeze for so long, that change is happening, and that they should expect a bill. Any sort of increase at that level will no doubt be alarming, no matter how much money we believe someone sitting in a band ETF or whatever have got in their pocket. People live to the expectation, and I think they'll appreciate having a bill like that coming in their direction, but it's a responsibility of government to make sure they're aware.
Right, okay. Derek Yule?
Yeah, I was just going to add to that. I would strongly advise the Scottish Government to take responsibility and ownership of the policy and to explain that clearly. I think councils will do what they can, but you will end up with 32 different messages going across there. I think I would strongly advise the Government to put out a message that it clearly explains what the policy objective is. I think one of the points made in the submission was about accountability, and for any tax system to work well, there needs to be clear accountability. And I think the fear I have is the confusion that will be created in the public mind if councils take the opportunity to increase tax by 3%. So the government has placed a cap on that. So it won't just be the impact of the multiplier, it will be the up to 3% increase as well. That will cause confusion in the public mind. And I think the fundamental policy change of the redistribution of the 100 million nationally, I think we've already seen how the press have reacted to that, the funding in one council area going to another council area, and how that's been perceived. So I think that potentially presents us with additional challenges in collection, not just in terms of the scale of the increase, but how public perceive what effectively up till now has been a local tax for local services. The idea of that being redistributed and the money going to other council areas will give an additional challenge. And I think how the public react to that will have to be very, very clearly explained to them.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Reel. Anyone else want to come in relation to that? Paul Manning?
The only, I mean, at the risk of repeating what Derek's just said, essentially there is likely to be confusion over what is increasing in people's bills. And I think on behalf of the four councils, we would look to the government to play a part in publicising the reasons for these increases and the logic behind them.
Okay. I've got a supplementary on that, but Andy, do you want to develop that line of questioning?
Thank you for that. In relation to the water and sewerage charges, you say that the government's been silent on any changes to that. Can we assume, therefore, that given this order has been tabled, and orders need to be tabled in good time to be ready for the next financial year, that any changes to the water and sewerage charges would themselves require an order, as I understand it, under the Water Industry Scotland Act 2002, and therefore, if no such order has been tabled or no intimation has been given that it will be tabled, it's fair to assume that there will be no change to the charging regime for water and sewerage.
And no reason to doubt Mr. Whiteman at all, but that would seem fairly clear if accurate. So,
did you have any more information on that? I mean, you just said you didn't know, so that's.
And I think that's basically, we don't know, and I think the point that you make is entirely right. It's the uncertainty. I think my understanding is, yes, it is a separate order for water. That charge is set nationally. I suppose we're trying to differentiate between what the actual charge is and how that's applied at the moment to the eight council tax bands. And it's the banding question I think we probably have most uncertainty over. My anticipation, I guess, was that the multiplier would apply as well, and there's potentially significant additional income will be raised in terms of water and sewerage charges unless the government reduces the actual rate. The proportion, I couldn't tell you offhand what the proportion is, but if the multiplier is going to raise an extra 100 million in council tax, then there will be a significant additional sum raised for water and sewerage unless the rate itself is lowered.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Neal, can I just check? You said the legislative position, you're fairly certain there would have to be an order laid for a multiplier to be added to water and sewerage. That's correct, that's your understanding?
That's my understanding, yes, I would have expected that, and I think we do need clarity on that.
And that hasn't happened?
No.
Right, that hasn't happened. Have you asked the Scottish Government?
Personally, no, we haven't raised that with them yet. So I think through COSLA that the point has been raised with civil servants. They are aware of that, but there's been no response yet to. And I think that's from the civil servants and the water element of the Scottish Government that we would be expecting clarification of that.
Well, hopefully we'll get clarity next week off the Cabinet Secretary, but it would appear that if you need to lay an order in relation to making this happen, the order hasn't been laid, it's not been intimated it's going to happen. As far as we understand, £100 million raised isn't based on water or sewerage charges, no. Then it would appear that it's not going to happen. So could it be a red herring?
I don't think it's a red herring in terms of the administration of the water charges, because to me there's a question of how much you raise as a charge and how it's applied to the property bandings as they stand at the moment. So there's the two separate elements of
but
that.
But either way, there's uncertainty.
Yes.
You need clarity on. Okay, sorry, Andy White, let you back in there.
Yes, just as Derek Yule said, the bands are not changing. There's still eight bands, and there's a rate charged by Scottish Water for that band. The question is whether there will be an impact on Scottish Water's charging regime, which may not require a separate order. That may be Scottish Water who decide that for themselves. I don't know.
No, I think that's right. It is generally a matter for them. I think the question I'm posing is how it's implied, what the implications are if we're applying the existing council tax bandings, which are applied at the moment to water as well, or whether the multiplier is applied to the element that's charged for water.
Yeah. Okay. On this point, Graham Simpson,
Yes. So if the new multiplier isn't applied to water, that makes it all the more confusing for you to implement.
That would give us a major problem. I think we'd potentially envisage a doubling up of the bills. We'd have to issue separate bills for water and sewage, or there would be significant software implications of that, and that would give us concerns in terms of the timescale for implementation.
Okay. So we definitely need clarity on that point. Can I follow up on it's the same
if
sort
it,
of issue.
If it's on this, does anyone want to go into the public awareness aspect of it before we follow up on?
Well, it's the public that. Awareness, yeah. Really. So from what you were saying, gentlemen, would I be right in thinking that you would like to be able, when you send out the council tax bills, to say an element of this is down to the Scottish Government. So this bit is down to the Scottish Government, this bit is down to your local council.
I would suggest that it would be fair to do that. I would hope that the Scottish Government would put out publication in advance of that to make people aware, or an awareness programme to make people aware in advance of the council tax going up. That's the bit that is set by government, and once it goes through Parliament, it will be in play. The other part of the bill that will come with be if council increase their council tax within the cap that is put on from the Scottish Government as well. But we believe that council, that the government should go out early and make sure that people are aware.
What I'm asking Councillor Keenan then is when the council tax bills go out, and perhaps the finance directors here may know this, are you actually allowed to separate it down in the way I'm suggesting?
Can I maybe answer for a political point of view? I think that a few years ago, Aberdeen done something differently. Obviously got challenged, and I don't think there was any backlash on that. So I would suggest that council would be in a position. The 32 different messages that go out are probably based on 32 political differences, and hence the reason that the message would be better put out for the government, in which case it would be clear.
I'm going to hold back from my supplementary on this. Kenneth Gibson.
Yes, well, I mean, I think public awareness isn't going to be an issue. There's a local authority elections next year, and I think there'll be plenty of coverage of this in the media, and no doubt political parties will certainly mention it on their campaign literature. I mean, so Councillor Keenan, are you suggesting that the Scottish Government should say, we're responsible for X percentage increase in your council tax, for example, to band taxpayers? Do you think they should then put out a letter to people in A to D saying, by the way, we're not putting your tax up, it's the local council's fault that it's going to be 3%. I mean, that's the other side of this coin, isn't it? It becomes too, surely it would be interpreted as far too political, you know, overtly political in that regard, whereby you're suggesting the Scottish Government effectively takes the blame for putting council taxes up after a 9-year freeze for people from E to H. But should that not mean they should then take the credit for continuing to freeze it from A to D?
I've never been able to influence what the Scottish Government puts out as in their communication, but I think there is a message that's incumbent upon them to make sure that they are responsible for telling people the taxes that they intend to implement. You know, and if they want to exercise a bit further or go a bit further than that and claim some other credit in some way, they can feel free to do so.
Okay.
Okay, Dave. What are lots of other MSPs wanting to have supplementaries on this? You've got their interest with those answers, Mr. Watson.
If I could, I mean, our position's always been that, you know, and we said it in our evidence, that the council tax is difficult politically. We understand that the challenges with politicians, which is why we've always argued to seek a cross-party consensus on reforming the council tax, because we understand this ain't easy. I think, yeah, frankly, our members certainly would be less interested in who's to blame. I understand the argument that, obviously, this is the Scottish Government, I think, in our view, unwisely ring fencing a chunk of that money, so that I think councils are entitled to explain. What we'd call for, however, is that for government and councils, when the tax is going to increase, particularly after such a long freeze, I think it's very important we don't just focus on the fact that it's going up, it's what it pays for, you know, what it's doing. Good communication is about saying to people that actually, I know it's a difficult message, but tax is actually a good thing. It's council tax may be tricky, but it's a good thing. It pays for good things. It pays for the things that you and your children want, whether it's education, social work, or anything else. And I think we should be focusing on that as a communication message, rather than, frankly, getting into a political rammy over who's responsible for what bit of it.
Okay. I don't know if Mr. Manning wants to add anything to that. How do we avoid a political rammy, Mr. Manning?
Well, that's a leading question.
What can you do to avoid that happening, Mr. Manning?
Okay, right. Right, I feel on the spot now. Right. With the council tax bill, there is an obligation to put out what amounts to an explanatory accompanying note or letter, which details that the background to the council tax figure and local authority expenditure. I would have thought in each of the 32 local authorities, given that this is the first time in almost 10 years there will be any increase in council tax, and it may come from two different directions, there is going to be within each authority a step taken to say this relates to the amount which is coming from a decision taken by the council, and this relates to an amount coming from a decision taken by the government. That would be an explanatory accompanying material that goes out, but I don't think on the face of the council tax bill.
Can I just check something? I know witnesses here may have wished the Scottish Government to go further than they have gone, but I'm assuming, or maybe I shouldn't assume, that witnesses here support local authorities being able to increase the council tax once more. I mean, just is there a general consensus in relation to that? Okay. The consensus may splinter in relation to whether that should be capped at 3%. We might explore that later, but there are general consensus that council tax should start to increase again. Is there a consensus that the multipliers for bands E to H should be more progressive than they have been in the past? Is there a consensus in relation to that? Does anyone disagree with having an additional multiplier? Put to one side who gets the money and how the money is used. Does anyone actually disagree in relation to a rebanding multiplier for bands E through to H?
Don't disagree with you, but I don't think it goes far enough with the point of view. If there'll be quite a number of properties across the country that have been extended by an endless amount, and
Councillor Keenan will definitely come on to that.
And when it comes to discount schemes or whatever, then local government's proposals or the proposals that were moved forward were there was more checks and balances to see that the thing was delivered much more fairly.
Right, but so I just want to check on this one, because I want to just get to a kind of final point in relation to this. Everyone here agrees that council, local authorities should be able to be increased their council tax again should they choose to. Everyone agrees that there should be valuations to one side, revaluations, I've no doubt we'll come on to look at that this morning as well. Everyone agrees there should be an alteration to the rebanding multiplier for E through to H. Does anyone disagree with that here today?
I don't think it's a case of just doing E2H. I think there needs to be a review across all the bands.
Sure.
I mean, at the moment, a £40,000 house, as a £400,000 one, the difference is only three. So we, if you look at the Spice briefing and the Commission's report, they showed a number of different modellings. So we'd urge, obviously, government to look at those modellings rather than just look at those four bands. If your question is, are we in favour of greater progressivity, then the answer is yes.
Yeah, I suppose.
I don't think Cosler agree with the fact that it's only within these three bands and that there needed to be someone that went further.
Right, I suppose the point I'm trying to get to is if everyone agrees that there should be council tax increases again, if everyone agrees that there has to be greater progressivity, and what we're debating is whether the current Scottish Government proposals go far enough, and I put to one side, Elaine Smith's going to go and look at this in terms of local democracy in relation to how that money will or won't be spent. The conversation we've had for the last 20 minutes seems to be in relation to everyone agrees council tax should go up, it should be more progressive, it's going to happen, but we seem to be in a blame game about whose fault it is rather than collegiately working between Scottish Government, COSLA and the local government partnership. So can I ask whether or not there's been any discussions between COSLA or the local government partnership and the Scottish Government in relation to how you could work together to promote this system? Heaven forfend that letter that drops through the letterbox of every household with their council tax bill could have an agreed insert between the Scottish Government and each local authority. And that might even, heaven forfend, be standardised to make it more efficient to actually produce. Is this out with the realms of of achieving and taking somewhere we can some of the politics out of it.
And I think from the point of view of me representing a COSLA that would like to see local government having the ability to decide whether it raises or freezes or whatever without government imposing these things on them is really COSLA's position. It might well be that we've got members that can continue with a council tax freeze for a period. It might well be that, you know, others would have preferred to put it up more than the band that's been. It's about local democracy and local accountability. And what's being presented by government doesn't allow that.
I'll take Elaine Smith in for the next question in relation to that in a second. But that's not the question I asked, to be fair. The question I asked is, has there been any conversation with the cause of the local government partnership with the Scottish Government saying, well, look, we all agree that the direction of travel is correct. There's significant caveats in relation to revaluation, whether all the bands should have been looked at rather than E to H. We can have discussions about the council tax reduction scheme and how we move on in relation to that. And I hope that question goes up from members here today. But there, in some respects, there's significant agreement between government and local authorities. Have local authorities via COSLA, a local government partnership, spoken about a joint approach to publicising this? And we can have the debate about who pays for that, be it government or otherwise. I'm not suggesting that council should necessarily pay for it, but has there been any representation of the Scottish Government saying, let's do a joint approach and let's get the politics out of this, because there's a huge amount you actually agree on. So, Councillor Keenan, has there been any representations?
I don't think there has been any. There's not been any move from government either to suggest on how they would prefer us to handle it in any way either. So,
and we'll ask the same question to Derek Mackay next week as well in relation to that. Mr. You'll take it in a second, but Mr. Manning, I did mention your organisation as well.
Yeah, I'm not aware of any dialogue.
Right, and would it be a good thing? Do you think that would be a good thing for local government partnership to do?
I think it's a step that's a... represents common sense moving forward.
That's really helpful. Do you think, Councillor Keenan?
Probably a good move as well.
Right, so partnership working could still happen even in relation to this. Mr. Gill, sorry, I cut you off.
No, it's fine. I think I was going to sort of comment from a sort of practitioner perspective rather than a political perspective. I think it would have helped to have been an early dialogue for us to understand what the government's thinking was behind this. I think it appeared as an announcement rather focusing on the 100 million. And then we got into all sort of debates about what that meant for local accountability and whatnot. I think we would have liked to have understood what the reason behind, why was the figure, what was the political directive behind that. One of the accusations or jokes always made about accountants is that you look at an issue and say, what, you start from the point of view of what the answer is, rather than, and it struck me as that the answer was 100 million, and then it worked backwards to see what changes would be made to the multiplier to get there. And I think we'd have liked to have understood why that was being proposed. And as I said in the submission, I think we'd like to go that further, but more than happy to work with the government in terms of how we can best implement.
Yeah, thank you. That's really helpful for putting on the record. Now, before Elaine, thank you for your patience. Before we move to the local democracy angle, Ruth McGuire, do you have a final supplementary in relation to this?
Thanks, Convener. We've kind of moved on a little bit, but it was around the Directors of Finance evidence in that it would be fairly easy to implement, but we've heard some stuff there about the complications around actual collection, and I just wanted to be clear what those were, if it was around the clarification that was needed on the water and sewage and whether there would need to be two bills. I have to say, intuitively, the thought of having messages about where your tax was coming from on people's bills sounded like it would not be helpful in a practical sense, you know, taking the political out of it. So that was really just what I was wanting to hear about.
Okay. Anyone want to come in relation to that? Mr. Reo?
If I can, I mean, I think that was the point. From the discussions we've had with software suppliers, we don't think it's a particularly material change in the core structure of what, there are very few council tax systems, there's only a few suppliers of the software. It seems to us to be a fairly straightforward change to make. I think without going back over what I said earlier, I think the big complication would be if you had a different multiplier effectively of bandings in relation to water charges. I think it's something we are very strong to emphasise. The economies of scale of doing billing on behalf of Scottish Water for water and sewage, it's a much more effective way of collection. and we'd certainly want to see that continuing. But I just want, it was important for the committee to understand that is the, I think what we would anticipate has been the single biggest challenge in terms of implementing the proposed changes.
Anyone else need to want to add to that? Okay, no takers. Alexander Stewart, sorry, I missed you off my list there.
We've had such a lengthy freeze. Is there any anticipation that when the new bills go out and the charges change? Now, council tax collection varies across the 32 local authorities, but it's been quite standardised because of the freeze. Is there an anticipation that could be a backlash and that may have a reduction on the collection rate that the councils may end up having because of this?
Yeah. I think I would flag it up as a risk. How big a risk it is, I'm not entirely sure. We have had some insight to the government's calculation. It assumes a 97.1% collection level, which is a sort of Scottish average. I think you're also looking at the upper end. So in terms of ability to pay, we would see this as a stronger group in terms of payment. I know from my own authority, we have a significant proportion of customers in those four bandings paying by direct debit. So I would highlight it as a risk. I think my key point is round about accountability and how people perceive the fairness of the changes. You are talking about significant increases. I think if it's back to the communication, if people understand why they've been asked to pay more, then you have more chance of collecting the tax if people accept it. I think you only have to go back to poll tax or community charge to see what happened when you had a tax situation that people did not accept. And I'm not suggesting for one minute that these changes are anything remotely like that, but I think it does highlight that people's perceptions of a tax, whatever the tax is, has to be seen to be fair and understood. Otherwise, you do get into potential challenges.
Thank you, Camille.
Any other witnesses want to add to that before we move to Elaine Smith? Okay, Elaine.
Thank you, Convener, which actually I think brings us nicely into moving on. Can I thank you all for coming to help us with a scrutiny of this? So if we put the 3% to one side, just in terms of what everyone's been speaking about, because if local authorities decide to use up to 3%, then they will obviously justify that themselves and justify what they're going to spend on, what their decisions are, to the local communities that they serve. So I'll just set that aside a moment. If we just look then at the changes to the higher bands, we took some evidence last week. Questions were asked and answered about whether it was more progressive, less regressive, was it a fairer thing to do? So I'd be quite interested in comments on that. I do have some specific questions for Dave Watson, but could I just pick up on, with Councillor Keenan maybe, on something that was being explored earlier? So back to the issue of, I suppose, blame, justification, who's responsible for this element of the extra funding that people are going to be paying. Do you think that the councils then would be happy with, would they think it was more progressive, would they be happy to implement these changes to the higher bands if in fact they then decided where the funding was going? Is it the issue around local democracy and local decision making that in some ways it may be seen as a sort of reverse, I think I used that term last week, a reverse string fencing whereby you're going to be the councils are going to be adding the funding on, the government is going to then, rather than give you extra money for ring fencing for some policy decision that they want delivered, they're actually going to then take that and deliver it on the attainment fund. Is that the basic issue?
I mean, I think there's a real issue in local democracy, and in local democracy, we're obviously elected and we should have the ability to make the decisions to deliver for the individuals that we represent. I think there is, at times, a need for a collective for in the best interests of Scotland, these could be discussed. This looks to be something that's imposed on local government. The attainment challenge, looking to improve attainment levels, is something that's at the forefront of every local authority and I think we would be looking at ways to deliver that. I think we talked earlier about how we could do things differently if there was a partnership. Let's not apportion the blame. And I think there would have been that level of opportunity if there had been the level of discussion. Clearly, the COSLA and members of the Scottish Government got involved in looking at a commission to decide on how to replace council tax, and we don't think this goes far enough. It does, in some aspects, it all look like there's a ring fence money, and I dare say across government you may well hear that from a number of other councils that say, you know, teacher numbers, police numbers, or whatever, there are other areas where they feel that local spend is curtailed because there's an element of this is a demand of government. There needs to be some level of demand of local government if we're moving in partnership together.
So would you be more relaxed with this change to the bands if you then got to decide, if your members then got to decide what to do with the extra funding?
I mean, I think there's an element of we in local government would prefer to deliver fairness, and hence the reason there was a number of checks and balances that went into the proposals that we put forward jointly. And, you know, that would have seen ability to discount in areas. So allowing that local amount of flexibility, we believe, would have made a difference and brought around a much fairer tax.
OK.
Just be given an opportunity to respond.
Mr. Manning, maybe, or Mr. Hill?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's very much a political issue in terms of government policy, but I think it's probably fair to say councils generally would have welcomed the additional flexibility. Budgets are becoming under greater and greater pressure, and I think this is where you get the difference between what's local spending priorities and what's national government priorities. I think one of the issues I would flag up, it was about sort of community empowerment and that policy direction of travel, because the government has also indicated that it wishes 1% of council budgets to be determined locally. And I do have a question as where that sits on one hand against something that we perceive as maybe a greater centralisation of policy there. There seems to me to be a slight conflict there. And I think if we are looking at sort of 1% funding to be determined locally, how that sits with something, our policy that's raising council tax, but which is then going for a national policy and being redistributed. So I think there's a potential conflict in there. And I think that's about, back to that point about communication again, how these varying policies fit together.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Mann, did you want to add anything?
Again, just to echo what Derek said a second ago, I mean, in terms of flexibility, had this been given to local authorities or had they had the discretion to use this money, it would have been much needed flexibility during a period of time when our finances are being squeezed. But the perception is that it's going towards a centrally determined priority.
And if there was extra funding found for the centrally determined priority that wasn't the funding in these bands at local level, would that be more acceptable?
If it was separate money which was coming from the government towards the local government settlement, I think that would be more acceptable.
So that would be a move back to ring fencing, but with extra money for a government priority to be delivered by a local agencies, if you like?
From the perception that it's government money funding a government priority.
Okay, thanks. Could I turn to Dave Watson, convener, if you don't mind? just looking at Unison's submission. Is it on the same theme? Unison are saying in the submission that you're supportive of the government's aim to close the attainment gap. While you're supportive of that, ring fencing money raised by local taxation contravenes the principle of local control over local taxation. Could you maybe just expand a bit on that?
Yes, I mean, our position, we've always opposed the ring fencing of funds. You can argue this is sort of reverse ring fencing, but nonetheless, it's essentially a form of ring fencing. And we actually welcome, I mean, the Scottish Government made some moves some years ago to reduce a lot of the bitty bits of funds, and we welcome that. But then when putting back in with police numbers, teacher numbers, and the council tax freeze, of course, was all a form of ring fencing. You know, local government is not the same as an NDPB or another government department. You know, know, councillors are directly elected, they're responsible to their electorates. Local taxation, and I think Andy Whiteman and others have made the point about the charter for local government. There are principles here which do apply across Europe and elsewhere, that local government raises its taxes for its local priorities. I think if central government wants to identify its own priorities, it wants to influence policy, it can do it in a number of ways. It doesn't always have to do it with money. I mean, there are other ways that it can set national standards. We don't have any problem with that. But the in terms of the local taxation, that should be applied to local priorities, and councillors should be responsible to their electorate for those local decisions.
But then I suppose, sorry, can I?
Of course, yes.
But then I suppose the same question arises, that if the government, who are overall responsible for education and will take the blame, if you like, for what goes wrong with education across Scotland, if children aren't attaining, then obviously the government will be subject to questions in this place day in, day out on that. So if they were to find funding themselves because that's what they want to prioritise, but given that education is delivered at local level, they were then to identify that as extra funding. Is there a from what you say, you seem to think that that is ring fencing and that would be a problem.
Yeah, I mean, to be honest, in my many years in this role, I have to say that, you know, ministers are frequently use the Not Me Gov defence when approached on these matters. It's why, frankly, we have NDPBs and many other all set up for exactly the same purpose. I do, however, think there's a difference with local government because of the direct elections to them, and I think government does need to reflect that. And I think there is a debate that we've not really got a grip of. We're touching upon it here with funding. There's a wider issue about the role of local government and the role of central government, and I think inevitably with different administrations there are different pressures, but yeah, we're very clear that in our view that, you know, these local government is a good thing. Local decision making, subsidiarity should be the principle that should apply here. So decisions should be taken at the lowest possible level. That should be the principle. And I don't think taking money out of local taxation raised locally is consistent with that principle.
And finally, you say in the submission the Reformed Council's tax is still a regressive tax.
Yes, I mean, we can get, and I know, I think from memory, you had some interesting academic debates with the professors on the meaning of progressivity. You know, at the risk I'm a mere lawyer, and so I don't engage in the fine points of that. To me, I think the council tax is not, I accept in that sense, purely progressive. I think it is possible to make it more progressive, and I think if you look at your, I'm sure you have done, if you look at the chart that Spice have helpfully extracted from the commission, that shows a way which, well, I would call a more proportionate allocation, if to avoid any academic rows. And I think if we applied that sort of proportionality, we'd get a better scheme.
Thank you.
Okay, I suppose just for clarity, that was really helpful putting all of that on the record, Mr. Watson. The question we asked in our call for evidence, it'll be in your submission, we tried to see, is it more progressive or is it less regressive? And that was the debate last week. We were simply asking, is it fairer? And what we seemed to get from last week, yes, a bit, is kind of what we got. So is that a reasonable, I don't want to kind of misinterpret what you're saying.
Yeah, I'm always happy for you to put words in my mouth, but I'd have to say that yes, I think it is more aggressive, it's slightly fairer. Not surprisingly, we always want to go further.
Absolutely, and I can understand that. Now, there's no other bids from... we do have bids. And far be it for me to put words in the mouth of my MSP colleagues, but I'm conscious we haven't touched on council tax reduction or revaluation, and we've got about 15 minutes left. But let's see what you ask. Mr. Gibson, we'll take you first.
Thank you, Convener. I was going to ask about those, really. I mean, I'm intrigued in the submissions talk about how local government should raise about 50% of its income on its own, and that's been consistent across the board for a number of years. But, I mean, how realistic is that? Mr. Watson, you've said in the last line of your submission, it's time to stop tinkering and act on the recommendations for a new fair property tax. But over what timescale could that be delivered, even if there was... cross-party support on that, because the figures that have been presented, 15% of local government income is council tax, 7% charges, Unless you were to return non-domestic rates to local authorities, which could be an argument, although there's issues about, you know, how much Edinburgh would raise relative to, for example, where I am, North Ayrshire, you would actually, to get that 50% figure without non-domestic rates, you would have to increase a council tax from 15 to 43% of income, which would be a tripling. And unless there was also a concomitant reduction in income tax, which the Scottish Government now has some powers over to do, then that would be horrific for council taxpayers, as I'm sure you would appreciate. So I'm just wondering how... We can always say, yeah, it'd be great if local authorities raised 50%, but how realistic is it to do that? And just one other point, in terms of raising the council tax, because of this 15%, to raise a local authority's budget by 1%, you effectively have to now raise the council tax by 6.6% because of the gearing effect, all else being equal. So is this a blunt tool that is kind of past its sell-by date, or should we look at other more innovative ways of funding local government?
This is to answer. Who wants to take that
Dave
one?
Watson first.
Oh, yeah. Mr. Watson, sorry.
I think obviously you read our submission. Our view is that there needs to be a broader reform of the council tax, which is why obviously, yeah, we think this tweaking doesn't quite do it. Remember, the council tax used to be 20%. It's now down to 15% because of the council tax freeze. Although in fairness, charges weren't as high as they are now. There's been some plugging of the gap by charges, which we would argue is a regressive way of raising local government funding. We do favour the return of business rates to local, and we've long argued that should be the case. The phrase "return to" is important there, and in fairness, that wasn't this government that's done a long time ago. So I think there is a case for a broader reform. We broadly favour the Burt proposals, the property tax. In my view, that was a very, very thorough piece of work. I think some useful updating by the recent commission. I think if you look at business rates, you look at a new property tax, which may raise different sums of money. There's always been an element of charging there. Yes, it is true, and we do make the point that the risk with a lot of these is that rich areas gain more than poor areas. I think that's where equalisation comes from, and I think there are equalisation schemes historically have been placed. They're not easy because inevitably there are winners and losers, and I would say that one of the reasons I think where this tends to be right is we tend to focus equalisation schemes on whole local authorities, and the problem in Scotland is that our local authorities are a rather strange mix of big regions and quite small areas. I would restructure the equalisation agents by going down to almost to postcode areas and build them up. It might not result in massively different changes, but I think it's more realistic because even in councils that generally have a very high proportion of low-income households, that's not true for the whole council area. You know, there are wealthy parts of Glasgow, there are lots of parts which are not the same in your own area, the three towns, etc. There are big differences between that and Largs. So I think if you build up from local postcode areas and build up a formula based on that, I think that would get you a more realistic formula which would target resources where they're most needed. So I agree, you know, I'm not going to do it overnight. Even if you gave me a blank check and we rewrote the whole of the local taxation system, we would introduce give councils the power to raise additional local taxes, for example. The bed tax is a well-known version of that. We think there's some merit, possibly as a national tax, to look at things like land value tax, not as a replacement for the council tax, for a lot of practical reasons that our members in valuation point out are difficult. But I think you pull all those together, you could get somewhere fairly close to around 50%. It's an arbitrary figure. All we're really saying is that more money should be raised locally, and we think a broader reform, hopefully on a cross-party basis, that may be my wishful thinking, but nonetheless, that's what I think needs to happen. And I think then we would get closer to that local government ideal.
But that would be commensurate, I would take it, with a reduction in national taxation. Otherwise, you'll end up with your members and others as being burdened by additional taxes right across the board. I mean, would you see it as a kind of concomitant exercise, basically?
I think yes and no, and because we favour a property tax, I don't think, I mean, if we had a local income tax, for example, then that would be a double hit on working people. But I think by having that basket of taxes, as it's sometimes called, I think you minimise the risk of that.
Okay, Mr. Gibson, I think it's only reasonable to give the other witness an opportunity to talk about how we broaden out that tax base to getting close to 50%. So I know Councillor Keenan's maybe keen to talk about that.
COSLA had a commission on strengthening local democracy, and within that paper, obviously, there's quite a number of thoughts on how we can bring around closer to local government having 40 or 50% of its tax-raising powers, as we believe we play a vital role in the government of the country. We offered government probably over a year ago to do some modelling work on the business rates and how we realised that that would need to be some equalising factor across different areas. Some industrial areas have an ability to raise that much more. So we would look to do that. So I think we're, you know, and no taking up that opportunity, then we're probably a year or so behind where we could have been. We would have had an indication of where these figures were if that joint work was going. I would suggest that COSLA would still be keen to do that if government would take it on board. But we would like to see a better property tax and more powers. And whilst at the moment, obviously, some colleagues within council will not be happy at a 1% going into local areas, I've not got an issue with that. I think that, you know, decisions are best made as local as they can, and the centralising agenda for government's no overly helpful at the moment.
Okay, Derek Euler, Paul Manning wants to add to how we broaden out that tax base.
I think probably most of the points I would have made have been covered. I think Mr. Gibson's probably highlighted it exactly, that if you wish to move to near a 50-50 split, then returning business rates to local control would be probably the only way to do it. I think it's probably fair to say we have mixed views about that, because they do recognise the financial risks associated with that. And I'm aware of some areas of Scotland, if there have been major closures particularly, can have a significant impact on a council's finances if they're exposed to that risk. So whilst it's probably a welcome direction of travel, I think you do have to recognise the risks associated with that. I think it's also very keen to explore additional means of taxation. I think that the bed tax or tourism tax is one in particular. I know from my own council area it's something be quite interested to pursue. And I think when I see the way that the local hotel industry has responded to demand, the supply and demand and variations in price, I think that is an area that's certainly worth exploring.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Manning, do you want to add anything to that? Okay, Andy Whiteman, you forgo that. Now, just for completeness, I think, and my apologies, we're running out of time, but a few of you mentioned revaluation at the outset. I know there'll be evidence in written submissions. Maybe one or two of you want to pick up just a little bit, say something in relation to revaluation, which clearly the government's not doing. We got evidence on that last week, just to get something on the public record, perhaps. Any takers in relation to that? Okay, we'll take Dave Watson and Councillor Keenan.
I think we very strongly believe that there should be revaluation. I accept there are some risks involved in that, but with responsibility always comes risks in terms of volatility. But to tell people, and this communication exercise we talked about earlier is crucial, to then to say to people, well, actually, your property is going to be valued on 1991, is going to make it twice as difficult to make that change. So when 57% of properties are in the wrong band, you know, you just can imagine what people are going to be turning up in front of our members and saying. So please, yeah, we really do believe that getting, if you can say the government, look, we really do need to tackle revaluation, tackle that as an issue, get it right, and then let's start to talk about regular revaluations. Because my question would be, when's government ever going to do it? Are we going to do another 10 years or another 15 years? We've really got to do it now.
Get some of that on the record. Councillor Keenan?
I think it's just about delivering fairness. I think if there is somebody that's extended their property by 3 or 4 bedrooms and added endless facilities in there, that, you know, the chances are that would have been in a much higher band. And it's about them obviously paying what they should in the direction of the services that they use in local government.
Okay, only because we're running out of time, apologies for not going to other witnesses. I know Councillor Kinney had wanted to put that on the record earlier, and I'd kind of moved on. Council tax reduction scheme, I think estimated at 54,000 households, I think, would, well, clearly there already is a council tax reduction scheme, but the enhancement of it would be extended roughly to around 54,000 households in bands E through to H for, I think, net incomes under £25,000. Apologies, we'll correct the record if I got those numbers wrong, with potentially a tapered scheme, which we have no details on yet, the tapered scheme above that, to be fair. Just any comments on that? I mean, it's like saying, aren't good things nice? I'm assuming you welcome that. It's more, I'm not putting words in the mouth, Mr. Watson, it's more about challenges in relation to implementing that and getting that right and making sure those that already don't get council tax reduction apply for it. Anything with some evidence last week in relation to that, so anything maybe to put on the record?
It's probably just a potential for another administration cost that wasn't there before, but I think you need to ask that perhaps one of the directors of finance to give a comment on that as to where they see the costs involved in that. Anything that delivers to someone that's a bit poorer, then I would welcome.
Okay. Mr. Manning?
In terms of the changes for the higher bands, right, in terms of council tax reduction subsidy, it's there. It provides a mitigating effect for those people, but it's only going to be as effective as the level of uptake. So if there are people who don't engage, they have to know about the ability to get that benefit. So we have to, there's going to be a resource required in order to generate an awareness whereby they make contact with us.
Record, Mr. Euler, Mr. Sharma, this might be a last opportunity to have a comment to commit on if you want to add anything to that. Mr. Euler, first of all.
I think they're generally supportive. I think it's important the government recognises that there will be people in these top four bandings who would be entitled to or be impacted by the changes and their ability to pay. So it's important that it's recognised, that change is welcomed. I think the points have been made about additional administration associated with that, we do recognise that, but generally terms, we would welcome the proposals.
Okay, Mr. Sharma, don't you want to add anything?
Only really to say that we are collecting information from the councils around the council tax reduction administration cost as well.
Okay, well, can I thank all five witnesses for coming to committee this morning. Sorry, those last few questions were quite condensed. I just wanted to give you the opportunity to put some of that on the public record. So that ends consideration under agenda item one. We will, of course, hear from the Cabinet Secretary next week as we continue our evidence on the statute instruments. So we'll move on from agenda item one just now, but we'll suspend briefly.
Okay, good morning everyone. We're going to move back into public session and we move to agenda item 2, which is the draft second climate change report and proposals and policies RPP2. And the committee will take evidence on progress made with the second climate change report and proposals and policies. Today's session is a precursor to the committee's scrutiny of the draft third climate change report on proposals and policies RPP3, due to be laid in January 2017. Today's evidence session will take place in a roundtable format to allow for a more free-flowing discussion of the issues. It doesn't always work out this way, but usually a success of a roundtable event means that MSPs talk less and the witnesses talk more, but we'll see how that actually goes. I would normally introduce the witnesses at this stage, but rather than do that, I think we should all introduce ourselves and then we'll move to the first question after that. So I'm Bob Dorris, I'm convener of the Local Government Committee, and thank you for coming along here this morning.
Hi, Chris Woodgee. I'm Vice Chair of the Sustainable Scotland Network, and for a day job, I look after energy and sustainability for Dumfries and Galloway Council. Thank you.
Alexander Stewart, MSP, current councillor in Perth Cross Council and a member of Mid Scotland and Fife.
Hi, I'm Mike Thornton. I'm the head of the Energy Saving Trust team in Scotland, and obviously the Energy Saving Trust delivers some significant programmes for the Scottish Government, which help deliver the policies under the RPP, not least the Home Energy Scotland network.
Andy Whiteman, MSP for Lothian.
Fabrice Lebec, I'm Energy and Climate Policy Officer at WOF Scotland, and I'm here today representing Stop Climate Chaos Scotland, which is a group of organisations that campaigns to tackle climate change.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Ruth Maguire. I'm MSP for Cunningham South, and I listen as well as I talk, so this will be a good session for me.
Hey, good morning. I'm Craig McLaren. I'm Director of the Royal Town Planning Institute, covering Scotland and the Republic of Ireland. I'll be the professional body for town planners.
Graham Simpson, MSP for Central Scotland.
Kenneth Gibson, MSP for Cunningham North.
Lane Smith, MSP Central Scotland.
Harry McGuigan, Councillor, North Lanarkshire, and Community Wellbeing and Safety, representative of COSLA, Chair of COSLA.
Silke Eastbrun, COSLA, Housing Portfolio.
Okay, thank you everyone, you're most welcome. Before we move to the first question, can I just intimate to the committee that Councillor Harry McGuigan and Silke Eastbrun will need to leave around 12 o'clock, so when you slip off quietly, thank you very much in advance for your contribution here this morning. We'll get a chance to do it at the end of the evidence session, so just to put that on the record. We'll move to the first question, Andy Whiteman.
A very general question about moving from RPP1 and RPP2 and what we've learnt from that to RPP3, and whether you think that RPP3 is going to be just a continuation of a similar scale of increase in effort, or whether you think we are now at a stage where we need to make a much more dramatic step change in efforts to tackle climate change.
Okay, Mike Thornton.
What we've done with the previous RPPs is lay some solid foundations, but there is now a need, as you intimate, for a step change in order to maintain track. So I think the lessons that I've learned can drive that step change, which probably needs to be in things like renewable heat and district heating, and in energy efficiency, which obviously is boded well by the strategic infrastructure priority in that area. But yes, there's a, I suppose we would say there was now a need to crack on, is that, if I can put it colloquially.
Okay. Yes, Chris, would you?
I think I would endorse that. It's working from a local authority perspective, we've got good foundations in there. We're starting to record what we're doing much more effectively. That information is available. But we know there's big gaps in particularly demand reduction, particularly the renewables, etc., in actually trying to get more on the ground and to increase the scale of what we're doing to meet the targets we've got.
Okay, thank you, Fabrice.
Thank you. I think it's helpful to look overall at the picture of emissions reduction in Scotland when we're looking back at the last RPP and ahead to the next one. I think the last couple of years since the RPP2 was passed, we've had good emissions reduction, which shows policies can work, and that's been reflected in this year's first hit annual target. When we look at the how those emissions targets have been met, we see good progress in some sectors, so electricity and waste, and that's sort of showing the benefits of the deployment of renewable electricity in the electricity sector. However, some areas of the economy haven't seen quite the same emissions reduction. So in particular, I'd say buildings, especially housing and transport, are areas where we haven't seen significant progress. So for example, if you adjust for recent winters and weather, housing emissions have only fallen about 4% since the Climate Act was passed in 2009, which compares to 30% in electricity and 50% in waste. So I think the challenge with the RPP3 will be extending the good work that's been done in those two sectors to these other areas. And I think a priority for this committee, in my mind, would be looking at those housing emissions and reflecting what Chris and Mike have said, looking at the energy efficiency of our buildings. I think that's a really key area. So in specific policy areas like that, I think there's a lot of work to be done. And the RPP is a really great opportunity to actually step up our game.
Okay, thank you. I don't know if any other witnesses want to add to that. Councillor McGuigan, and then I'll take Mr McLaren after that. Yeah.
Yeah, we would also endorse the need for a step change in order to ensure that we do tackle the issues in a purposeful and effective way. However, you know, we need also to be in early in terms of working between the national aspirations and the local in order to show that there is a synergy that comes from that, that will enable us to make sure that we are tackling things in a complementary way rather than in any confusing way. And that can sometimes happen. So we would endorse it. There is a need for a step change, but we should never move away from the reality that without the necessary resources and without ensuring that locally we are able to engage fully and use the skills and the knowledge that are out there in the localities, then it will be very, very difficult to effect that step change. Thank you.
Thank you. Craig McLaren?
I think, like others, I think there's a good progress being made on this, and we should build upon that, certainly. I'd like to see something which allowed us to become much more transformational in the change we're trying to achieve. And one of the things I would like to see is to plan for it much more. I think it's interesting when you look at RPP just now. It's 322 pages. There are four paragraphs on planning in it. So there's a system there which can help you to achieve what we're trying to achieve, but it's probably been underutilised and not been held up and recognised enough. So I think if you've got something which allows us to take forward a planned approach, which is coherent but at the same time focused, that would help us to achieve those targets.
Okay, now I might have a supplementary here, but Andy, I'd rather give you the opportunity to develop your line of questioning.
Thanks very much. I mean, these are just opening dialogue. As we move towards seeing RPP3. I was interested in the point you made, Craig, about planning. It strikes me that we've got a new Planning Act coming along, got a new Forestry Act coming along. I mean, is there potential to take the basic statutory frameworks for things like forestry and planning, both of which can make contributions to climate change, and putting the necessity to tackle climate change as a core purpose of these systems? I mean, would that help?
I think that there's been some changes made already which have helped. If you look at the National Planning Framework, which was published in June 2014, and the Scottish Planning Policy published at the same time, they're now working to four outcomes, one of which is based upon a low-carbon economy. So that's central to what we should be trying to achieve. The issue I have with National Planning Framework and with Scottish Planning Policy is they're seen very much as planning documents, and they actually should be much more influential than that. They should be there to try and coordinate how we approach our development of different places, how we develop our infrastructure, to try and make sure we do take forward a low-carbon economy. That's not really the case just now. In my mind, and you would say I would say this as a planner, but I do think that having a national plan which doesn't have that influence, which doesn't have that ability to influence decisions, policies, and where we put resources, I think we're missing a trick there.
There is, of course, going to be a new national planning framework and a planning bill coming forward to this Parliament. So we'll be scrutinising that anyway. As we go through that scrutiny, what should we be looking out for? So give us some tips on what we should be looking out for as we feel like we mainstream RPP3, if you like, in the work of this committee. I don't know if you want to follow that, Mr McLaren or anyone else. I'll take you in a second, Delaney.
I think there's lots of things we should be doing. The planning review, which is underway just now, to be honest with you, it's focusing more on the processes and procedures of planning, and we're doing some work which is trying to look at what the big picture issues are, what we're trying to achieve, what type of Scotland we want, and what type of planning system we need to have to do that. So we'll be publishing some stuff on that in the next few weeks. Key to that is a low carbon economy, and planning can be helped provide a route map to try and get to elements of that. I think there are some issues in terms of how planning is perceived and how it's used, which actually might help us to do that. We've talked about in the planning review how the system has to be a much more corporate and collaborative system. As I say, it has to have much more influence in local government and in Scottish government. We talk about how we need to front load things much more, and we need to have the discussions and the debates about what we want to try and achieve at the start of the process, where we all can work out what we can contribute and what we can do, rather than at the end of the process where we're immediately in some form of conflict. We've also talked about the idea of planning being much more focused on delivering things. It's linking resource to the vision, which isn't always there just now. So things like that, I think, would help us to meet the targets and the objectives we have in terms of a low-carbon Scotland.
OK, thank you very much, Mr McLaren. I am going to take Aileen Smith in a second. I should point out to witnesses that I can be a bit dim sometimes. If people don't really blatantly catch my eye to speak, then I won't know you want to speak. So before I go to Aileen, you don't need to speak on planning, but this would be your opportunity to feed something in at this point. Anyone want to comment on that? Fabrice?
Yeah, thank you. I think just more generally in terms of what you can do with the RPP once it's out and continuing the scrutiny, like you say, mainstreaming it, it's not a policy. It's not a document that should sit in isolation. I think one of the problems with RPP2 is there hasn't been any process where we've gone back and monitored or verified whether policies are actually implemented and whether the emissions reductions have been delivered. So I think it's really key for committees and for the Parliament to continue the work of the RPP. It will contain lots of policies and proposals, and the key is to look out for the implementation of those through other bills. So the RPP should instigate and set in motion some new policies. They could end up in all sorts of different consultations and bills. But it's really key that the pressure is kept up, because what we've seen with past RPPs have been policies and proposals which have been in the document and then have kind of sat there and haven't been implemented. So, for example, if we go all the way back to the RPP1, we had a proposal to apply regulation to the housing stock, so for minimum energy efficiency standards. That was in RPP1. It was in RPP2. And it still hasn't been consulted on, so it's been endlessly delayed. So I think one of the ways you can mainstream it is to look out for those key measures and see if they are actually popping up elsewhere.
Mike Thornton, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, again, sort of conflating that point with the one about planning, I think that in the initial two RPPs, what we've had is a sort of national plan with a small p, and we've had some policies at useful scale to deliver the first steps on that plan. But I think there is a need, both in planning and things like regulation of energy efficiency of domestic stock, to have a national framework which supports the policy delivery. And of course, those are the decisions which are large scale. They're obviously have winners and losers, and they are perhaps more difficult decisions. But I think we have now reached the stage where those sorts of decisions need to be made and implemented, both in planning and in other bits of national legislation.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. Aileen Smith.
Thanks, Convener. It's back to what Mr. McLaren, Craig McLaren, was saying, actually. And I just wonder whether, talking about maybe getting it right at the start of processes, I don't know what members round the table and guests round the table think about maybe conflicting aims. And I would give an example of a proposal, a planning proposal for an incinerator in a local community, for example. So that might be argued for by meeting some of the aims of RPP, but the local community may not want that in their community. Where does that leave local government, for example? Do the arguments around RPP then override the community empowerment arguments that we're trying to make about people in the local communities? And I'm not posing it just as a question to Mr. McLaren, I'm just putting it out there as something maybe for consideration, although he may want to have a comment on it.
It's a perfectly valid point, and it's an issue. We have at a local level in trying to implement a climate change and low carbon policies, planners are always up against other priorities and other initiatives as well. A key thing just now you could probably argue is housing, delivering more housing, planning professions under the cosh to try and make sure it delivers as many housings as we possibly can. Does that always mean we're going to locate them in sustainable places? There's a balance and a lot of work to be done to try and make sure we can make that happen. So the planner's job is often trying to navigate its way through those different conflicting interests to try and come up with something which either suits some people or, to be honest with you, sometimes will not meet the requirements that some people want and need, and they might not be happy with it. But that might be the public interest or the greater interest.
Okay, anyone else want to add to that? Okay, do you want to come back in relation to that, Elaine?
I would go back to the RPPs the effectiveness of them. I think they have been a very useful tool to have operated in the delivery of what we're talking about here, carbon emission reductions and so on. I think we have to try and make sure that the resources that are needed to effect those, what is being highlighted in the RPPs are well understood. We shouldn't pay lip service to something that we quite like the idea, we like the aspiration, but the resources are not going to be there to make that. And that's territory that we do have to get into very, very early as far as RPP 3 is concerned. We welcome it. You also have to bear in mind that in local authorities, we find ourselves in a situation where we're also having to deliver in the 50,000 homes. Yeah, and we want to do that. It's a desirable thing. But the resources are scant, and we set a budget last year that was a horrendous budget locally in my own area, something that I never thought I would see as a politician in all the years that I've come, I've been around. But we need to have the assurances that from the RPP that resources can and will be found. So I know I'm hammering the point a little bit, but that's crucial. We're kidding ourselves on if we don't raise the profile on that one. Thank you.
Okay. Maybe follow up in some of that. You mentioned the 50,000 affordable homes target and a significant investment of taxpayers' money into funding that ambitious commitment. Are you confident that these new homes that will emerge will have suitable energy efficiency as standard? I mean, it's an assumed fact that new social housing tends to be the most energy efficient in the business, so to speak. I think 35,000 of the 50,000 is earmarked at least to be social housing, I think. And the balance, some could be social, some might not be. What about the energy efficiency? And I'm speaking from ignorance here, I do apologise. What about the balance of energy efficiency for the other, say, up to 15,000? Will they have the same, will they be built to the same energy efficiency standards as social housing? I'll take Councillor McGuigan and I'll take Mike Thornton on that.
Disgrace if that were not the case, if we were to apply a two-tier system, and we would be fighting to make sure that we did tackle that.
I mean, I'm not saying there is, I just don't.
It's a good point you make, Chair.
Mike Thornton.
Whatever the tenure, therefore, because they're new houses, they will be 45% more carbon efficient than if they'd been built in 2007, which is obviously a significant gain. I suppose, however, this, from the point of view of the domestic housing stock, this does slightly highlight that two things. First of all, that most of the houses that we're going to live in by the time the climate change targets have to be met are already built and have people living in them. So energy efficient new housing stops things getting worse, but only retrofitting existing housing can actually make them better. So it's kind of, one is a necessary condition, but it's not a sufficient condition. I think the other point that you made yourself about social housing being the most efficient sector by tenure, which it is in terms of carbon and therefore in terms of energy bills for the people who live in it generally, that's the case. And the reason is because the government has regulated for that sector and it's regulated for energy efficiency. And that's the reason that I think that there's such a strong consensus
certainly I would imagine around in the people around this table as witnesses, that there should be an extension of a regulatory approach beyond that sector, because basically it works.
Okay, now we might come and explore how we put greater regulation on the private rented sector or owner-occupiers or buy-to-let in a moment, but just sticking with the 50,000, I suppose, at the moment, just about how we can maximise the benefit from that. I know Craig McLaren had indicated that he wished to add something.
Thanks, Convener. I was just wanting to say, as we've heard already, that there are fairly stringent building standards for new housing now, which means there should be a high quality in terms of energy efficiency in there. The thing we don't often take account of, however, is the location of those new houses. And we need to think about how they can be made to work in a way which actually minimises any impact in terms of carbon. We need to look at the fact that they're linked to public transport or they're extensions of existing settlements, which build on the infrastructure which is there, which minimises the need for new infrastructure. Or we manage to open up sustainable sites through investing in infrastructure as well. So there's a need to think not just about the housing unit, which I think is one of the things that RPP does. It doesn't think about where we put those units and how important it is to think about locations in terms of that being about sustainable development as well.
Have we came full circle? And we mentioned the planning review and from this committee's initial looks at that, work around the reforming of Section 75 agreements and planning gain and the idea of a... apologies for the terminology wrong, a kind of levy on that money so it's then banked to then go for infrastructure and other types of sustainable development. So is that maybe something we... any comments in relation to how we use procurement, be it through the affordable housing target or just the large housing developers picking a field somewhere, whatever, and saying, I'm building 400 units there, and they're seeking planning permission for that, about the kind of levies we can put in relation to building in sustainability. Is there more we can do in relation to that? Mr. McLaren?
I'm happy to come in again, yeah.
Yeah.
We've been saying for some time now that the Section 75 model is in a bit of crisis because developers are crying foul that it's too expensive for them to deliver those other facilities as well as housing, and it's left to the state to try and pick up the pieces. We think there's maybe more of a role for the state in taking this forward, a bigger role for Scottish Government and for local government to use almost a continental model where we actually provide the infrastructure, we red carpet the infrastructure in, and we de-risk sites, we pick the sites which we think are developable, and we leave house builders to actually develop those sites, which are essentially service sites. The issue with that is it's a change in culture. It means we have to do stuff much more up front than we do just now. And it's also an issue in terms of finance, because it means more up front finance as well, at a time when we're not in the best position in terms of finances.
And can I just, we'll take you in a second, Councillor McGregor, is that almost in terms of, in a positive way, directing the market so you red carpet the sites that you believe will lead to sustainable housing developments with all the benefits for the future RPP3
absolutely.
As well?
Yes, absolutely.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay, Councillor McGuigan, do you want to?
I couldn't add to that. It's exactly the sentiments I wanted to express, and well expressed.
Chris Woodgie, did you want to?
I think it's common that sort of things happen with industrial development in the past, where the sites are pre-started. But particularly if you're looking at things like heat networks, the additional infrastructure costs of putting heat pipe networks around, it would perhaps help with developing, you know, local heat networks for new housing developments, because by the time the planning's in, it's almost too late to get that sort of infrastructure in place. So I think that sounds a really positive idea.
Elaine Smith, did you want to come in on that?
Thanks. I don't know if this is moving you on to the regulations we're going to move on to, but it's just someone mentioned earlier the building regulations. I just wondered if they're still, are they still fit for purpose for all of this? What is the role of building control officers? Do we have enough of them, or are the companies now more self-regulating with building control standards? So I'm interested in that whole area too and how that fits in.
Okay, then I want to take up on that. Oh, a couple of bids in that. Mike Thornton, take you.
One of the things that we mentioned in this area in our written evidence was I think the building regulation pathway that the Scottish Government's adopted has been a good one. We would argue that the trajectory should continue, if you like, into the future, but I think there is another aspect of it which is also perhaps worthy of the committee's attention, which is that basically when you build a house to a certain standard, you assume that that standard is met in the house, and that's a perfectly reasonable policy, but at the moment it's not necessarily backed up by the sufficient testing and monitoring to be absolutely sure that the carbon savings that, if you like, the Scottish Government is booking against its targets are actually being achieved. And we think there's a need for some attention in that area.
Okay, any additional comments in relation to that? Is it specifically, I'm keen to move on to other questions as well, Andy, but is it specifically on that? Okay, can I just mop up something around, I think it was Craig McLaren that mentioned, did you mention community heat and power initiatives? One of the witnesses mentioned, was it yourself, Chris, mentioned that. So the committee visited the Wynford Estate in my constituency to look at a community heating system, and there, and that was maybe a 50, 60-year-old development that's then retrofitted using grants and monies from power companies and the like. The 50,000 new affordable homes, is there an anticipation that it's much easier to put in a combined heat and power system or a new community heating system from scratch as you're building 600 units in a community? Is there an anticipation that will just happen? Is there an indication from Scottish Government that when Housing Association and others go forward for Housing Association grants, they're looking to expect these kind of things to be part of the mix, and perhaps that requires funds from another source rather than just conventional HAG funding as well, a cocktail of funding to achieve that? So I don't know if there's any comments in relation to that, or if you've got any information, Fabrice.
The Scottish Government did convene a group to look at the role of regulation to support district heat networks, and looking at, Mike was actually on the group, so I don't prejudicing your comments, but they looked at kind of what needs to be done to improve the rollout of district heat, and do local authorities have the powers? And the report, the group makes several recommendations, and I think there is a lot more that could be done to give local authorities planning powers and others to require district heat networks in new developments. Likewise, to obligate people who might have waste heat to contribute to those district heat networks. So I think, in answer to your question, there's a lot more that could be done. And I think there is a proposal for a warm homes bill within this Parliament. And I think that would be a great opportunity, actually, to take forward the recommendations from the group to increase the powers that local authorities have. So the kind of example you've just given, we're more likely to see these new developments have district heat networks. My guess is that the new builds that we're talking about probably won't have district heat networks, because they do take a long planning and a lot of upfront investment.
Okay, and that would be disappointing, obviously, if they're not. I'll go to Mike Thornton, followed by Silky after that.
Yeah, I should declare an interest, because I did chair the Scottish Government Special Working Group on District Heating Regulation, as Fabrice alluded to. But I think, taking this back to a comment that I made earlier, that and the comments that have been made about the planning system, that what we're the answer to your question about the 50,000 new houses is that some of them may be on district heating. That may be planned into those developments or it may not. There's no decisive policy structure that will make that happen at the moment, despite the government's commitment to renewable and low carbon heat and the fact that district heating is a key route to that. And I think what on the working group on regulation, which had stakeholders from all sides, you know, private, public sector, and so on, the consensus was very much that unless something more forceful is done through the planning system and more forceful done through the regulatory system, then we accepted that these were harder choices, that they would require, if you like, more political capital to implement, but without that sort of choice being made and fairly directive regulatory background being put in, then you won't see the progress that the Scottish Government wants, which is to have a step change in district heating. So there are some very specific things that can be done, and in our view they should be done.
And just in relation to I'll come to you in a second, Silky, just in relation to that 50,000 target, it is now a government target. There's a timescale for that. You mentioned that to try and have additional developments as part of that 50,000 with district heating systems might cause delays and longer to go through a process. And governments like to meet targets.
Yes,
they don't like not to meet targets. And there's this dance every month or every quarter about housing new starts and housing completions and what number best suits one political party over another. If we took all of that out of it, is there a way around this? Is it more important to make sure we maximise the amount of homes from this 50,000 to have such things as district heating systems rather than hit bang on the 50,000 target within the timescale?
Well, I would slightly sidestep that question because we've covered already that new houses are built to higher regulatory standards, and so they use less energy in the first place. Actually, the economics of district heating are actually much more compelling for existing homes. So the real, you know, I mean, I'm not saying it would not be a good thing if new houses were used as a stimulus to put in district heating networks, but the real challenge is to get existing properties onto district heating networks. And for that, you need the sort of regulatory instruments that say, for example, that if you have a large building and you are upgrading its heating system, then you have to actively consider district heating as an option, and if it is of equivalent cost benefit to other systems, then you should go the district heating route. So, for example, local authorities who buildings might, maybe there should be a requirement that they should form the centerpiece of new district heating systems and should put in those in part as part of their normal development cycle. And you need to do that because if you want district heating systems that can then be built out and people, individual householders in existing homes can connect to them, you have to have a way to start them off. Sometimes a new build can be that opportunity, but it's not really going to be the universal panacea. You need to consider what can be done for the, you know, vast majority of existing homes.
Okay, that's actually very helpful. Puts it in a, places in a context, a realistic context. Silky, apologies.
Thank you very much. Just quickly wanted to come in, not on the on the new build affordable housing. Obviously, you know, local government is pulling out all stops to deliver towards the 35,000, you know, social housing here. But I think Mike made all those points. But I wanted to come in just on the district heating. District heating is a key component in the new SEEP program, the new kind of like infrastructure priority to run for the next 15 to 20 years from 2018 onwards. And local government's quite strongly involved in this program along the lines of Councillor McGuigan saying, you know, we need to be in there early and shape program design. So district heating is a key component in that. At the moment, we've got 11 local authorities throughout Scotland who are involved in the so-called SEEP pilots, which have got, you know, district heating as a key component. And in terms of supporting the overall development of the SEEP program from 2018 onwards, we have got a local government reference group that brings together all the different departments that would typically be involved, anybody from, you know, planning, housing, sustainability, finance, and so on. So that's quite a high-level group that is coming together to very strongly feed into program design, and district heating is a key component in that in terms of contributing to overall energy efficiency. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Andy Whiteman, you'd indicated to come in, and Alexander will take you after that, Andy.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Just following on from Mike's point about powers, as it were, for local authorities, do you, speaking principally to local authority representatives here, I mean, there's a lot of innovation going on across Europe in cities, particularly to move towards a low-carbon society. Do you believe that local government has all the powers it needs to be innovative, to experiment, to implement schemes to reduce carbon emissions? And the second question is, I think in a lot of your written evidence from all the participants here, you talk about the lack of monitoring and evaluation in RPP 1 and 2. I'm just wondering what a good system of monitoring and evaluation would look like.
Councillor McGuigan, more powers for local authorities?
I would say one of the very, and I've been a bit repetitive on this, but one of the big difficulties is not so much powers, but the resources to enable us to sensibly use those powers in a way that will enable us to hit the targets that we believe are necessary for the particular locality that we're dealing with. And I think that I've listened to some of the discussion. I think we have to be a bit guarded about thinking that we can come up with a template that we can hold up and say, that will, that we can apply that template right across Scotland. You cannot. There has to be that flexibility within the local authorities and the whole localism agenda. So in terms of the powers, there's obviously some powers, and maybe Silky will come in. You know, we've been in negotiation about some of them, but the main tool in all of this is for national government, local government, and others to recognise that if we're working together and pulling together and utilising the resources in a collectively and collaborative way, then we can overcome the issues that are problematic here. But we do have to make sure that the resources are there for, to enable us to do that.
I don't know if you wanted to come in or not, but you were certainly name-checked. I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
Just to fully back up what Councillor McWigan has said, and you know, yeah, it is absolutely essential that we, you know, that we can respond to local circumstances within a wider framework of wider national ambitious targets, but that we can have that constructive approach and that constructive partnership where individual authorities chase challenge funds and use a lot of resources on that one. That comes up with often a very fragmented approach and not the most effective use of resources. And given the financial pressures which exist for local government and everywhere else, the effectiveness of the approaches is really, you know, part of what can make a success here.
Actually, very helpful that you put that on the record. Thank you. Fabrice?
On to the second part of the question on what kind of monitoring and evaluation should be done. I think the first thing is it needs to be regular, perhaps each year. So we have annual climate targets, and there's a statement to Parliament as to whether the country's met it or not. There's no real deep dive into how that target's been met, and more specifically how all the policies in each sector are doing. So whilst we get a headline figure, we get, for example, this year, transport, once again highlighted as an area where not much is being done. But there's no process either within the Parliament or within government to then feed that back in and say, well, do we need to relook at what RPP2's what's being delivered and what policies are in place. So I think yearly evaluation needs to happen. It has to be embedded within government. And I think the parliamentary process, the parliamentary scrutiny, shouldn't be kept just the RPP production itself, but it needs to be with that annual target report as well. And finally, I think, again, just embedding it within the government's own kind of policy development. The Westminster government does a kind of a forecast of each year of where it thinks emissions are going and how policies are performing. In Scotland, we don't have that. So we have no way of kind of looking ahead and anticipating where our emissions are going and whether we're actually on track. So again, perhaps the Scottish government to produce its own kind of tracker so we can actually see how we're doing.
Okay, thank you. Chris, would you?
Obviously, this doesn't answer the whole question, but certainly with the public sector, with the mandatory reporting that starts up from November this year, which is built on what we've done with climate change declaration reporting over several years, particularly within local authorities, that is starting to give us a baseline and give us information that is becoming, I think, more robust. Being directly involved in trying to pull the figures together, there are challenges, you know, transport, even changing finance codes to enable us to report more effectively, is sort of helping to get us into the right place, but certainly in terms of our carbon emissions for buildings, for waste, etc., we're starting to get that. And there was a comment from, I think, Glasgow University with one of the colleagues in SSN that it's probably one of the better data sets that's developed. It's not perfect by any means, but it's a step in the right direction. The challenge will be to pick up the bigger gap of what's happening in the wider aspects of the country. You know, public sector is starting to get there, but it's sort of a good example to build on, I guess.
Okay, thank you. Is it specific? I was going to give Andy Whiteman a chance to come back. Mr. Simpson, is that a supplementary on this specific point? On a little bit.
No, I'm hoping to move the conversation on to the private sector.
Okay, I think because that's come up previously, I'll maybe take you in and then to Alexander Stewart after that, if that's okay. Graham Simpson.
Seems to me that there's a huge issue around homes that are already built, which is probably the vast majority. So the challenges, and I'm interested in people's views on how do we improve energy efficiency in buildings that are already there? And there are two sectors, private rented and privately owned. I had a chat with Fabrice yesterday, and Fabrice, you might want to comment on this, but he was telling me there seems to be a system down in England for the private rented sector where regulations appear to be stricter than they are here. But that doesn't apply to the privately owned sector. I think there's a real challenge there is how you get into, you know, so privately owned homes and improve the energy efficiency in them. Because as I said to Fabrice yesterday, if you knock on my door and tell me I've got to spend £100 on anything, I'm going to chase you. So that is a real challenge.
I'll make sure I don't knock on your door, Mr. Simpson.
Don't.
Fabrice.
I guess I'll set out how we can tackle the existing building stock. And I'm glad to say, Graham, that you recognise that it is, in terms of housing, it's probably the biggest challenge we have for emissions. I think the way you tackle the energy efficiency is we're kind of already doing it already, but we need to do more. So we have a grant system for the fuel poor. So if you're a low-income household, the government will subsidise the measures. For everyone else, we're proposing alongside regulation, which says if you're selling or renting a property, you can't do so after a certain date if your house doesn't meet a certain energy performance standard. And we're saying that should be implemented and backed up with loans, incentives to encourage householders to make these improvements. And yes, there is a cost associated with the upgrades, but let's remember that these upgrades, not only do they reduce your energy bill, so obviously you're investing to make yourself better off in the long run. It makes your home warmer, and it can add value to the property as well. And I think a key part of this, how we get this going, is using the energy performance certificates, which if you're renting a home, you already have. If you've bought or sold a home in the last 5 years, you also have. So the cornerstone of this programme is the Energy Performance Certificate, which tells you what improvements you can make. So I think we're already made a good start in Scotland with the Home Energy Efficiency Programme. And as has been alluded to, the Scottish Government's developing a new programme, Scotland's Energy Efficiency Programme, to start in 2018. But in order to deliver the kind of climate savings that we need, that programme needs to be backed up with regulation and a proper programme of loans, information and incentives for all householders. Otherwise, we'll see emissions from the housing stock flatlining as they currently are.
Okay. Graham, do you want to come back on that before I take other anything specific in relation to that answer?
Well, I think I think it's all very well if you step in when people put the houses up for sale or up for rent. But what if you don't? What if you've lived there a long time and you're going to live there a long time? So how do you get to these people?
Yes, please, now to Mike Thornton after
me. So there's different ways around that. There have been proposals to have a backstop. So all homes have to be brought up. So after the initial regulatory requirement, at a later date, any homes that haven't been back into the market and improved would need to be. And that would have to probably be enforced via local authorities. So there are solutions to that, and that is one of the smaller issues of the programme, but we do have a way around it.
Okay, thank you. Mike Thornton?
Just following up those points, I mean, the RPP policy horizon is quite long, the climate change targets policy horizon is quite long, so this wouldn't be about, you know, what happens to your home in the next 2 years. You put in the intention to regulate, and you are now what we might call regulatory shadow to influence people, so they know that eventually there will be a regulation when they sell their home, and that gives them a significant number of years to actually take action at a time that suits them. I think the point has been made that action will be ultimately will lead to them and their successors in the house being financially better off. So, you know, there's a sort of psychological resistance, but it's not. It's still a good thing both for the individual and for the Scottish society as a whole. I think there's another really stark fact about this, which is that in order, I mean, the The existing Homes Alliance for Scotland's suggested ambition for the strategic infrastructure priority for energy efficiency is that all homes should be an EPC rating of C by 2025. And there are various cost element estimates of that floating about. I wouldn't like to necessarily quote them to the nearest billion, but they're in the sort of £10 billion range. So that's a lot of money. And the question is, how's it to be found, given that it is actually required? If you don't do that, actually the climate change targets will ultimately be missed. It's that stark. So really there's a choice, and it's either to regulate, which is produces investment from homeowners and building owners to their own benefit, or it's some form of public sector subsidy, which would be very large and very, very difficult to produce, I would imagine, in times of financial stringency.
I suspect, given time constraints, we can't particularly tease out what regulation would look like. I'd written down compulsion and enforcement as two significant aspects of that if you decide to regulate, but I'll maybe just leave that hanging there. Can I just check, in terms of terminology, when the Home Energy Efficiency Programme was mentioned, I sat on this predecessor committee back in 2007 as a local government committee, and we were looking at that point. There's a political stooshy, actually, it's fair to say, about the central heating programme for older people, and the debate at the time was, should pensioners get their free central heating systems, or was it targeted at those most in fuel poor? Was it targeted at the most energy inefficient homes? And then through a few reincarnations, it became more and more targeted. Is that what the Home Energy Efficiency Programme, is that where we are now, or is that something different? Or where is that predecessor? It was the Energy Assistance Package, I think, the last time I was particularly looking at it. So where is that just now, I suppose? How focused is it? And I suspect, do we need a bit more support for the private sector, particularly things like tenemental properties and hard-to-heat homes?
I mean, at the moment, there are sort of twin tracks. There's a there's a programme of grants for highly targeted grants for fuel-poor households, which will get them insulation and efficient heating systems, and that's a national programme. And then there are what jargon people like myself refer to as HEAPS ABS, the area-based schemes under HEAPS, which are focused in specific geographical areas, and local authority people aren't here anymore, but are managed and delivered by local authorities. And I think these are really good programs, and I said at the beginning that we've done, under the previous two RPP periods, some really good things have been done, and they're part of that. But it's a question of a step up in scale, and I think that's the dilemma in policy terms that will need to be wrestled with: how to go from some very good programs at medium scale to the sort of truly large scale programs that are needed in order to get the housing stock up to, say, a C by 2025.
Okay, so just in terms of just my initial question, checking, are we there's a resource issue, and whether that's the public purse via subsidy or whether that's via compulsion of the private market, I suppose, putting the resource issue slightly to one side, for the public funds that are available, is it suitably targeted and focused at the moment, I suppose, is the question I'm asking.
It's an opinion, but my opinion, yes. The policy broadly can be described as, if you can't afford to do it but you need it, then the government programme will give you a grant in order to take you out of fuel poverty. And I think that's the right, the funds should be concentrated in the truly vulnerable, truly needy sector. And that is being done. But if you take that view, then, and you know that the climate change targets also mean that the able to pay sector has to improve as well, then you need another policy instrument to get that progress in that sector.
Okay, thanks. Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Following on from all of this, My issue I'd like to ask about is sufficient access to finance, because that to me seems to be the crux of the matter, is ensuring that we have enough money that we can get the access to it, and also maybe tapping into the private sector to complement what we're doing with the government sector to ensure that that can actually take place. And I'd like some sort of views on how we can get that, because if we manage to achieve some of that, then the measures will be implemented and many more, and that would give us a real chance.
Was also alluding to about upfront costs, yep, for households. Does anyone want to look at how we make this affordable for for households financing?
Green Deal.
See, you've all presented the problems. It's finding the solutions is more challenging. Any ideas? We'll give you a slight break, Mr. Thornton. We'll take Fabrice first, and then we'll take you in. Yeah.
So the HEAPS programme is kind of being redeveloped by government at the moment, and it's actually a really crucial time. The RPP comes at a great time for feeding into that process. We, as the Existing Homes Alliance, and I think Stop Quiet Care Scotland supports this as well, clearly you have to provide a financial offering if you're going to put a compulsion on people to improve their homes. There's different ways you can do that. So you use low interest government borrowing, provide low interest or zero interest loans. That's something that they've done in Germany with great success. So they use their development bank there, and they provide very low interest loans to people to cover the cost of doing these. There are other ways of doing this as well. Might be able to elaborate a bit more. Equity release is a different way of doing that. So there's a variety of solutions on the table. I think once more detail from the programme emerges, it would be really good to have scrutiny in the Parliament of how those proposals deliver.
Okay, that's really helpful. Mike Thornton.
Yeah, sorry, I don't mean to be talking so much. Just to add to that, there has to be a finance offering, and it's a brilliant time for the strategic infrastructure priority in terms of the financial climate. I mean, I know that sounds a bit perverse, but because capital costs are so low, that investment in energy efficiency is relatively cheap and relatively good. So there certainly are options for government incentivized loans and so on, because I think we all recognize there aren't going to be grants, and perhaps there even shouldn't be grants for the able to pay sector. I think the difficulty, though, and I'm beginning to sound a bit like a broken record, but if you think about it a little bit in terms of all our own experience, if, you know, actually one can go and borrow at very low rates for things right now. So if people actually wanted to put, say, solid wall insulation on their home, they can probably go out and get, you know, there aren't any solid wall loans, but there's plenty of loans for general purposes, and then get one of those, and they can probably get it at a fixed interest rate of 2 or 3%. And that would be a cost-effective thing for them to do. But in general, people don't do that. So the existence of a financial offering is, again, important. But if you don't have a lever for making people take it up, which I would argue is regulatory shadow or regulation itself, then it won't actually take the sector forward.
Thank you. Craig McLaren?
Can I talk about the sub-infrastructure side of this? I mentioned earlier on how we thought there was a role for governments at local and national level to come into the position earlier and to fund things earlier. There are some examples of where that's happened. You look to Dundee, where they've used prudential borrowing very, very cleverly to redevelop their city centre, and that's becoming a real fantastic place. It's a work in progress, but it's getting there. But the creativity in using prudential borrowing to invest in an area, and they'll get a return on that because they own the land, and they're in the process of... We're talking to developers and investors about how they will use that land, so they'll get a return on that as well. So there's something about thinking about that. There's also, I think, there are existing resources around which we could perhaps use better. I'm thinking particularly we have an infrastructure investment plan, which when I look at it sometimes, I worry that it concentrates on trying to get things and people from A to B, rather than thinking about how you can use infrastructure in a creative way to open up development opportunities or to try and make sure that we reach broader objectives. So there's something about how we can link that into, dare I say it, the national planning framework again, to try and take a longer term view and to try and get some more transformational change on things rather than a sort of short term view. I think the other key thing, where a lot of resources just now for development and for infrastructure, is the city deals and the city region deals. And when we look at them, I have a slight concern that they tend to be a list of projects which have been around for probably some time, which have not quite been picked off a shelf, but they've been identified as something that can be used because there's this additional funding there. I would like to have seen the city deals being much more about transformational change and more thought given to how those resources are used to initiate and develop that transformational change. So there might be a second round, or there might be opportunities in the existing city deals to look at how we best can do that as well. I suppose the last point I'd like to make about resourcing this is what we need to remember is if we use this money cleverly, it can be preventative spend, and that's really important in terms of carbon and energy efficiency. If you invest early and make the right decisions early, and make sure we don't have to mop up the pieces later on, that can make a major difference.
That's helpful, and you got my interest when you mentioned city deals. I'm tempted to go through my personal hobby horse from my previous existence, a regional MSP covering Glasgow region in relation to the Cathkin bypass part of the Glasgow city deal, which the communities that I represented at that time would rather have had better park and ride facilities and public transport infrastructure rather than a significant cost for some tarmac. But I'll leave that sitting there. I suppose I've done it now. The wider question, I suppose, is anyone checking the city deals to make sure that they're actually consistent with where climate target ambitions and targets? I suspect they're not then. Because Ruth's not had the opportunity to speak yet, we'll take Ruth in first, then Fabrice, I will take you in a second.
Just, Convener, interested on that point of sort of preventative spend, and I guess when we're talking about trying to change behaviour and get people to invest, you know, I think from a local authority or housing association perspective, having energy efficient buildings and homes, you know, is going to keep the stock in better quality, and, you know, do a bit to prevent fuel poverty. And it's just, I suppose, if that message is, if we're able to transfer that message to private housing, you know, if there's a bit of sort of carrot as well as stick that can be done in terms of changing behaviours around energy efficiency and investing in private properties.
Okay, that's helpful. Fabrice, did you want to come in?
Just on the point about the city deals and the infrastructure investment plan, to my knowledge, they're not. There's no process whereby the project that result from them, what carbon emissions they'll have. So one of the issues we've had in the past is there's been a focus on road building and heavy, high carbon infrastructure, and there's been no kind of scrutiny as to are these actually aligned with what the Climate Act requires. So it's definitely an area I'd highlight as needing an improvement.
Okay, and I should say I no longer represent that part of the world in Glasgow region. I'm Maryhill and Springburn now, but I thought just for clarity that had my interest at the time. Mr. McLaren, did you want to come back in?
Point which I've realised about city deals is what you've got to remember is the way in which they're structured. Local authorities put forward the proposals, they're analysed for what GVA they will give to the economy, and they'll only get the money from government once that GVA has been realised. So there's one point about if that will be realised, and two, the fact that the measure is GVA and how that ties in with what we're talking about around reducing carbon and climate change.
That's helpful. Graham Simpson, you sparked off this line of questioning. Any reflections on that? Do you want to come back in?
Yeah, sorry.
Oh, sorry, Elaine.
Just listening earlier to the conversations around investment and what happens in other countries, I think Fabrice mentioned loans and interest-free loans. How does the Green Investment Bank fit into this? Does anyone know? Does it fit in?
No one's desperate to make my eye contact, but Mike Thornton has done, of course. So Mike's going to tell you everything you want to know about it, Elaine.
Banking isn't exactly my specialist area, but I mean the Green Investment Bank in theory could access capital, which could then be on the capital markets, which could then be loaned out on a retail basis to individual householders. And that's essentially what happens in Germany. A bank that's owned by the German national government and the German states, KfW, borrows with, in effect, government backing, so incredibly cheaply on the capital markets, and then it lends that money on at a very cheap rate to consumer-orientated banks, and they then take a small percentage for their administrative costs and lend on at still a very cheap rate to individual householders. And this is a big-scale programme. It's aiming to do 2% of the German housing stock every year, which is a big number, and it only lends for specific increases in energy efficiency, so you can't just sort of say, oh, I fancy having this, but I don't fancy having that. You have to buy one of a number of packages, and then you get that costed and so on, and you get a loan. I guess the difficulty of reproducing that
model in the UK, never mind Scotland, is that there isn't, well, there might be some sort of semi-state-owned banks, but there aren't any state-directed banks. The GIB, I don't want to speak for them, but I mean, in theory, they could perhaps play a similar role. That would be kind of a policy matter, I guess, for them and the UK government, perhaps.
Even things like district heating schemes that you were talking about, is that something that they could be doing?
Yes, and I mean, again, I don't want to speak for them, but I know that, you know, they invest in a number of capital scale projects, and I would imagine that they have an interest in district heating amongst those. I mean, you know, they provide investment for things like biomass plants, aerobic digestion plants, all sorts of low carbon capital intensive projects, and they do lend a lot of money. So you know, I guess we can all see there's a potential connection. I just don't know how close that is to being realised.
Trying to find some of that out a bit more.
I think that would be a good thing for us to do. Chris, would you?
Just a quick comment. We've not, within Dumfries and Galloway, we've not explored that, but certainly within the non-domestic energy efficiency programme that's being supported through Scottish Government and Scottish Futures Trust, Green Investment Bank is one of the mechanisms that's suggested to fund the works to deliver energy efficiency across public sector buildings. But as I say, we've not gone that far because I think we'd probably start with prudential borrowing as a means of funding that sort of work in the first instance.
Graham, I'd previously said you might want to come back and give any reflections on what you've heard, because you'd kicked off a line of questioning and we'd kind of moved on. Is there anything you want to add? We're almost at the close of the session.
We've kind of got to a point, thanks to Elaine Smith's questioning, where we end up on a very positive idea of going to an organisation that's there now, the Green Investment Bank. And I think within this committee's remit, housing, we could be speaking to them and seeing if we can expand on those ideas. I think that's a great way to end that line of questioning.
Okay, and we're about to end our entire line of questioning in a second. But what I would do is I would give the opportunity for the witnesses that are here, if there's any reflection you want to make or comment you want to make, just to put on the official record before we draw to a close, because despite our attempts not to speak, the MSPs do take up a lot of airtime, so perhaps you don't always get to say precisely what's on your mind, or the lines of questioning go off on a tangent from what you were hoping to say today. So we'll maybe take it in the opposite order to which we did the opening introductions, and we'll maybe start with Mr. McLaren. Is there anything you want to add just before we formally close what is now this afternoon's session?
Not particularly anything I don't want to add, just to perhaps reinforce and reiterate that I think there's a role for planning and the planning system in this, which is understated at the moment. I think if we thought about how planning could fit in a more corporate way, in a more influential way, in a more collaborative way with different disciplines, different sectors and different agencies, we could take a medium to longer term view, which could have a real impact.
Okay, thank you. Fabrice, do you want to add anything?
Yeah, just to say, I think the session today has been really good. Glad to see the committee getting involved early with the RPP. Just a reminder that the RPP is a huge cross-government piece of work, and it affects, you know, as we've heard today, investment opportunities, the economy, health, as well as climate, obviously, and other things like fuel poverty. And I think, looking back to the old RPP, the scrutiny process happened entirely within committees. So I guess my final thought is just a reminder that your committees play a crucial role in actually making sure the RPP delivers what we need it to deliver. And so to keep up the good work, and when the RPP is published, obviously make it, I hope to see it, a big part of your work plan.
Thank you. Mike Thornton?
No, I think I've made the points that I wanted to, and thank you for the opportunity to do so.
Welcome. Chris, would you?
Just a couple of points. First one, that we're going to have a climate change plan. I think that's great, because RPP, if you're involved in it, you understand what it's all about. But climate change plan's a lot more accessible for people, so I think that's really good. I think it's important to make sure that we've got clear targets within that when it comes out. So we all, you know, as public sector, we know what our bit of that job is. So trying to go for smarter targets, some of it's a bit more woolly at the moment. I think that'd be really useful. And I think the other one, which we've touched on a lot as we go through, is just making sure that climate change is in the wider policy agendas across the board.
because it's quite easy to ignore it. And at the moment, we maybe can get away with ignoring it, but it's so important that we do deal with it effectively because it tackles fuel saving, all sorts of interesting ideas, and improves quality of life if we get it right, and that's critical.
Okay. Can I thank all the witnesses for coming along today, and also maybe draw attention to the witnesses that one way of making sure that our PP3 and climate change doesn't just get channeled to a kind of one-off evidence session once a year or whatever, of course, is to provide written evidence to the legislation that goes through this committee on a regular basis to give us the opportunity to have that aspect to question ministers and other stakeholders as we look at various legislation. So bear that in mind, follow the work of the committee, and please do contact us if there's anything else you want to add following today's evidence session. So that concludes agenda item 2. The committee will now move into private session, and can ask witnesses, members of the public to leave. Thank you.